Hi, it's Dwyer. I'm a civil attorney here in Northern California, and I like to examine famous cases that are in the news. Right? I can be found at richarddwyer.com. Also, my blog, it's a little politically tinged, keepingitfree.blogspot.com. There's a very popular podcast on iTunes, Serial. It discusses the murder case in which Adnan Syed got convicted. Now, in that case, I don't believe the state proved its case beyond a reasonable doubt. So I personally would not have voted to convict Adnan Syed. But as I've said in prior videos, I'm not sure if he's innocent. In other words, while the state didn't meet their burden of proof beyond a reasonable doubt, there's enough in that case where I'm not sure if Syed is factually innocent. Let's talk about a case where someone got convicted, has been in prison for more than a decade on a crime that I don't believe he committed. The name of this individual is David Temple, T-E-M-P-L-E. I would encourage you to Google the case, right? The prosecutor in that case went on to do many things, right? Currently has a television show. But the question here is whether or not David Temple actually killed his pregnant wife. It's a murder case, right? As the state alleged. Now, understand, his pregnant wife, 7 months pregnant, was found shot to death in the Temple household, right? The victim of a shotgun blast by a shotgun. Now, here's what people need to understand. That afternoon, David Temple was out with his son shopping. We know that beyond any doubt, because some of the stores where they were shopping had cameras. Now, the prosecution's theory is not that Temple hired someone to do the crime. The prosecution's theory is that Temple himself did the crime, then left the house, and then went out shopping to create an alibi. Right? People in stores see him. He is on the store's video system, right? With his son. Here's the problem with that scenario. And it's a bit racially tinged. By the way, Temple is a white guy. But understand, next door to where the Temples lived, in fact, it's across the backyard, right? A black family lived. There were two young black kids who were watching a television show, Dr. Doolittle, right? There came a time in that show where these two young black kids, one of them's only 6 years old, right? I mean young. When these two young black kids heard a shotgun blast, right? At about 4:40 p.m. that afternoon, these two kids hear a shotgun blast. Now, just by chance, literally just a few moments before the kids heard the shotgun blast, David Temple, who ends up being convicted for this murder, is actually caught on camera with his son at a Brookshire Brothers store across town. In other words, it's physically impossible for David Temple to have been in two places at one time, right? He's too far away, caught on a camera, to have actually then traveled back to his house to have fired the shotgun that these two kids heard. Now here's where it gets interesting. Right? How could Temple, who's caught on camera across town, actually been convicted of this murder, especially when he's with his young son? Right? Temple's not even alone across town. And the reason is because the prosecution wants you to believe that these two young kids, who keep in mind, never previously claimed that they heard a shotgun blast before this incident, right? Before this instance, right? And keep in mind, these two kids are certain that they heard gunfire. They're certain, right? The prosecution wants you to believe that these two kids, they both hear it, are mistaken, right? Both of these kids are wrong, right? The prosecution argues that nobody else in the neighborhood heard these gunshot blasts. But then inconsistently, the prosecutor argues if the kids heard something, it was something else. You know, either the kids heard something or they didn't. Right? If the kids heard something that they thought was a shotgun blast, or at a minimum, was gunfire, how likely is it that these kids could, for the first time in their lives, hear something that resembled gunfire by chance on a day in which their neighbor gets killed by gunfire, right? But yet the kids are mistaken. The neighbor gets killed the same day, but perhaps what the kids heard that same day was something other than gunfire. Understand, it's my contention that the fact that you have witnesses in the area who heard gunfire that doesn't match up with the prosecution's timeline by itself creates reasonable doubt. David Temple, who's caught on film across town, should never have been convicted of this crime. Keep in mind too, nobody else in the neighborhood hears any other gunfire that afternoon. But yet we know the gunfire existed because the victim was murdered that afternoon in her house. So the only ear witness, testimony that we have, or evidence that we have, are these two young kids who heard gunfire at around 4:40 p.m. when the accused couldn't have done the crime. Now, how Temple got convicted shows you what's wrong with our criminal justice system. It was discovered, lo and behold, that David Temple was having an affair right during his pregnancy with his wife. Right? The couple, they're 7 months pregnant. David Temple was stepping out on his wife with another woman. Okay, great. If the charge is simply whether or not David Temple committed adultery, all right, maybe the state can prove its burden there. That's not the charge. Right, focusing on his infidelity doesn't cure the defect in the timeline. Right, I would argue that his infidelity really is irrelevant here, unless you have some coherent theory on how he could have done the murder. So yes, he wasn't husband of the year. But that shouldn't hide the fact that he couldn't have done this murder at 4:40 when the two ear witnesses heard the gunshot. Right, to get around his unavailability at 4:40, believe it or not, the prosecution then makes the crazy argument that David Temple killed his wife well before 4:40, then leaves the house with his son to go shopping. And then when the ear witnesses hear the gunshot later, the prosecution wants you to believe they're mistaken. Right? I wish I were making this up. David Temple has been in prison for a long time. This crime took place in 1999. Right? He's been in prison for a very long time. Quite frankly, in my opinion, this case should never have gone to trial. Right? Let me point out, too, that there are other problematical things here. Apparently some kid in the neighborhood who was a chronic truant had had ongoing problems with David Temple's wife, the murder victim, who was a teacher at the local school. Right? The teacher had, in fact, reported this truant to his parents. Right? Now, this truant happens to have failed multiple lie detector tests. This truant apparently also had access to a shotgun. Believe it or not, the prosecution had this truant appear at trial and actually testify that no, he didn't kill the murder victim. Right? Why is this truant being given more credibility than David Temple, the accused? Right? If we're just going to convict someone based on a narrative, right? David Temple was cheating on his wife. She's 7 months pregnant. He must have killed her because he didn't want to be a father again with her. Right? If we're going to just reach conclusions on that and spend most of the trial developing evidence of the guy's infidelity and not the guy's opportunity to do the crime, then why isn't the neighborhood boy who's actually upset with David Temple's wife, has a motive, right, who has access to a shotgun and who fits the timeline a lot better than David Temple, why isn't he at least as feasible a suspect as the accused? In other words, if the accused is in no better position to do this crime than other people in the neighborhood, then how could the accused get convicted of a murder? So let me encourage everyone here. This to me is a clearer case than Adnan Syed and Serial. Let me invite everyone here to look up this case. It's a Texas case. It's David Temple. T-E-M-P-L-E, right? A guy convicted of murder, right? For a crime where if the ear witnesses, the only ear witnesses, are to be believed, happened at a time when the guy was literally caught on film across town shopping with his son. Right, let me point out too that there's a phone call to the victim's house shortly before the kids next door hear the gunshot. Right, and of course the answering machine picks up the call. Right, is it possible that someone is in the house when the call comes in? And then the kids hear the end result of that, the gunshot, after the call comes in and is not answered. Right? That's as feasible as anything suggested by the prosecution. Keep in mind, this isn't a civil case where you're just looking at a preponderance of the evidence. This is a criminal murder case where the prosecution has to prove things beyond a reasonable doubt. How can you possibly do that when there's an ear witness, in fact multiple, who hear the gunshot at 4:40 and the accused at that time is across town and wouldn't have had the opportunity to do the crime? Right? Really, it seems to me that David Temple got convicted because of adultery, not because of murder. Unfortunately, he's serving a murder sentence. I hope you give this case a look. If you're interested in this case, if you have facts you want to share, if you have an opinion on Temple's guilt or innocence and the reasons why you have that opinion, I hope you leave those comments here in the comment section to this video. Thanks for stopping by.